Hello everyone, I'm Norman Wahlberger and welcome to Algebraic Calculus. In this video I want to go through how to go through the Algebraic Calculus One course. So it's all happening on openlearning, which as you all know, I hope, is a very lovely MOOC platform that's developed in Australia. It's all online. The course is starting January 1st and going to the end of 2018. So throughout the 2018 the course will be running. There are 12 chapters. They're going to be running sequentially, month by month. There are modules. There's four of them per chapter. So each chapter has four modules, and each module has four sections. The sections of a module all look like this. There's a video and notes section. There's a worked problem section. There's a homework questions section. And there's a section on links, definitions, and notation. And there's little icons here for these three different sections. So that's the overall structure of the Algebraic Calculus 1 course. All right, so let me make some suggestions to you. First of all, it's a good idea to try to keep up with the course. In other words, to try to do one chapter per month. I know there'll be all kinds of people with different schedules, and it doesn't mean you have to do this. You can start later on in the year. But still, it's kind of a nice idea to try to follow along so that most of us are going through roughly at the same pace. So one chapter a month, that translates to one module a week, roughly. Four modules in a chapter. Okay, so there's various things to do. Obviously, the first thing to do is to watch the video and read the notes. That's the first section. And then read the work problems or do them. So the solutions are hidden until you click on them. So you are able to go through the work problems and solve a lot of them yourself if you are able to do so. And if you are, I encourage you to do that. But otherwise, just read them. Read the problems and read the solutions. And then the homework questions, the third section, where you actually have to do some work. I want you to do the homework questions. So you've read the notes, watched the video, you've looked at the work problems, you understand sort of how they go. Now you have a chance to apply that understanding yourself in solving explicit problems. I suggest you have a dedicated notebook, you write stuff down somewhere, be it on pen and paper or electronically, but some place where you can record what you're doing. Now, in addition to this, there's always on every page opportunities for asking questions, making comments, responding to other people's comments. So open learning is a very communicative environment, and we're able to make a lot of inputs, comments, questions, responding to other people's comments and so on, and I encourage you to do all of that. And then finally, the fourth section, links, definition, and notation, is kind of a place where things are summarized and where you can find extra information to supplement the things that you've learned in the module. Every so often, one of the homework questions will ask you to post something, to post a solution of a problem. And you have various options for putting stuff up there, a text, a file, maybe even a video or something like this. So you can experiment a little bit. And the contributions then of the participants will be visible in the gallery, and we can all sort of check out different ideas that people have for solving problems. So might experiment a little bit with that. That might should be fun. So again, with comments and questions, an integral part of the course, we want to communicate, we want to interact. So again, ask questions, please respond to others' questions. Please point out typos and errors. There will be lots of places where we can improve the course for sure. And I'll be most grateful if you can give me feedback so we can improve the course. So the suggestions that you make, that's great. You can also add more info, give some references, provide some additional links. So lots of opportunity for you to engage with doing stuff in the course. Now, it very well may happen that you have a good idea about some additional questions or additional problems that would illustrate some interesting aspect of the discussion. So if you do, I'd be most grateful to those. So in that case, please send me an email with a concise description of your idea. You don't have to send me the entire problem at the beginning, but send me just a quick email and we can talk about it. And then if it's good, then I'll ask you maybe for some more detail or maybe even a LaTeX or Markdown copy so I can sort of cut and paste it in a good spot. So I'm going to be aiming to actually have quite a substantial collection of questions and problems. It's one of my ultimate goals. We're not going to be there at the beginning, but as the course develops and as future courses go, we'll be able to enhance our pool supply of problems, and I think that'll be great. And I'm also going to attribute people's contributions, so you give me a contribution and we'll put your name up there so that everybody will know that you've contributed. So my legal team has also asked me to make sure that we all understand about copyright. So the idea is that the ownership of the copyright of all contributed materials to the course will reside with Wild Egg Proprietary Limited and myself, NJ Weilberger. So if you do submit something, it's under the condition that the copyright and ownership of that material will be passed to our company. So the company has a web page at wildegg.com, and of course it's also the publishing company of my book, which I hope you all know about and hopefully some of you will have read. Divine Proportions, Rational Trigonometry to Universal Geometry in 2005, which was really the starting point in some sense for a lot of this development into modern rational thinking and 21st century mathematics. So yes, that's our company, that's our little logo there. Now I realize there will be quite a wide range of people taking the course, from first year undergraduates to university mathematics professors, and quite a range in between. So I want to try to capture as many of you as I can, but there will therefore be a spread of levels of material. Now, to make that a little bit easier, I'm coding the questions with E's, M's, and H's for easy, medium, and hard. So if you're a beginner student, first year student, then make sure you can do all of the easy questions, and don't worry too much if you can't do any of the hard ones. That's something that you're aiming towards, and maybe in the fullness of time you'll be able to understand what's going on with these harder problems. And occasionally there will be a sort of a research level type question, or one that's considerably more challenging, at least maybe, and that'll be denoted by C. But typically easy, medium, hard. In terms of assumed knowledge, well, I'm not going to assume all that much knowledge. The aim is to bring a large range of participants together. So I want us to proceed together in this space, even though we may be of widely differing backgrounds and experience. But generally, I'm thinking of a first-year uni student who has a strong mathematics background and ability in mathematics, and or somebody who has mathematical maturity, but not necessarily a prior understanding of calculus. So very important that we do not need a prior understanding of calculus for this course. And in some ways, the more calculus that you know, maybe the more challenging it will be to reorient yourself from looking this way, you've been looking at this way for a long time, to moving in a different direction, facing a different direction, and looking at a different vista. Okay, really the same thing, but you're looking at it in a substantially different way. So it actually, in some level, is more challenging for somebody with a lot of experience in calculus. So if you're a university lecturer, you've been lecturing calculus for a long time, don't underestimate the challenge that you're facing in going through this course. Okay, it will be challenging for you. There's a lot of different aspects of calculus, but somehow at the bottom of things, sort of the essential framework, really comes down to the continuum and our number systems that we're using to structure the fundamental objects that everything is being built out of. This is an understanding that has only gradually over the centuries, or maybe even over the millennia, gradually started to dawn on people that, you know, the more intensely we study the subject, the more it really comes down to knowing precisely what we're talking about in terms of the nature of the continuum and how we model it. We have to try to leave physical intuition and geometrical intuition behind, ultimately, and get down to saying exactly what we're talking about. Now, in this course, we're not going to be spending a lot of time on philosophical discussions about foundational issues. I don't want the course to be about that. Okay, I'm going to teach you calculus. So the math foundation side of things, that's going to be over in the math foundation series, and there'll be a lot of opportunities for you to engage with that series. But in this course, I want to steer you away from that. So let me, off the top, tell you sort of what our orientation is. We're going to assume a working understanding of natural numbers, integers, and rational numbers. And these are the types that we're going to use to refer to these numbers. So there's a number 3. We'll say that it's a natural number. It means it's of type nat. It means we look at it and our computer says, ah, that's a natural number. It belongs to that type. Here's -2. It belongs to the type integer. the way we've got it, okay, here, the natural numbers are then sort of sitting inside the integers and we don't distinguish between them. Okay, that's an effective way of proceeding from a pedagogical point of view. And then there are the rational numbers, which again, we're going to view them as extending the natural numbers and the integers and include what we usually call fractions like this, 15 over 7 minus 314 over 2005, but also decimal numbers, 7.45, which is just an alternate form for 7 and 45 hundredths. Okay, so that's our view on decimals. They're alternate expressions to describe certain types of fractions. What about irrational numbers? There are not going to be any irrational numbers in this course. None, okay? We may mention them occasionally, like that, you know, over the hill, but we are not going to be using irrational numbers. So cosine of 5, square root of 37, pi, etc., etc., no. And if we have to talk about these things, you know, with reference to the standard theory, let us agree, ladies and gentlemen, to put them in quotes. Okay, so we'll put them in quotes so that we all know that we are just temporarily talking about things which are not in our system clearly definable. Similarly, with infinite sets, we are not going to use infinite sets. We're not going to talk about the set of all natural numbers or the set of integers or the set of rationals or the set of real numbers. None of these are going to be used. But if we want to reference what other people are doing, what the literature is doing, we'll put quotation marks over them. So can we all agree on doing that? Okay, I think that's really great. That we'll agree that we're not going to promote the usual status quo just by using these terms in a way that suggests that, of course, we all understand what we're talking about. Cosine of 5. No, we'll put quotes around it, telling everybody, alerting everybody that this thing is not really part of our system. Even the natural numbers, the set of natural numbers, I have no idea what that means. It doesn't mean anything very precise to me. A particular natural number, you know, identifying whether what you've written down belongs to the type nat, yes. But we don't have to make any grandiose assumptions or conventions about all natural numbers going beyond the universe. Okay, so we're going to agree to that. We're not going to have a lot of discussion about that. I'm not going to encourage a lot of philosophical chit-chat about these things. Okay, it says calculus. We're doing computations. We've got a lot of explicit, really beautiful things to work out. So we do not have time for distractions. And in terms of two-dimensional space, three-dimensional spaces and so on, we are going to be needing that kind of thing. We're going to be connecting with linear algebra. And this is sort of how we'll do it. So our two-dimensional space, if we have to talk about it, it'll be A2. It's not a set. It again just refers to a type. So this is an object, 3, 4/5. That's a point, an affine point, we'll end up saying. That belongs to two-dimensional affine space. Okay? But we are going to avoid talking about infinite collections of stuff, because that to me is just nonsense. All right, so let's all agree that for the purposes of the course, that's going to be our common orientation. It's the common language that we're going to use. We're going to stay clear from anything that's even slightly problematic, that has a whiff of infinity or infinite procedures about it. Keep it outside the door, please. And finally, let me say once again that this 2018 course is a beta course. It means it's in development. It's not some kind of finalized product. I'm working hard to fix it up, to put in more stuff. I've got some helpers helping me. And it's going to have a bit of a rough and ready aspect as we go through the year, and that's perfectly fine. In addition, we're going to be incorporating a lot of the suggestions that your help and input will give us. Okay, so that's going to be a very important part of things. You're going to give us input, suggestions, feedback, and we're going to augment and change and modify things as best we can as we go along. All right, so I hope we are all together on that. Okay, there's going to be lots of opportunities for new insights here, new computations, new directions for thinking. We're mapping out a new orientation for modern pure mathematics with this course. And really reorienting the subject so that the 21st century, the new millennium, has a new mathematical direction. So that's what we're aiming for. There's much to learn. I'm Norman Wahlberger. Thanks for listening.